It's awesome.
And then one time it's like this one lady was like, "Oh, you can't swear in the store like that." He's like, "Yes, I can. It's a free country. First Amendment." You know, I'm a customer. It's like, I'm not bothering anybody. You just have an attitude with me, and I'm saying fuck you. That's all. You expressed how you feel. I'm expressing how I feel. And it's funny because like you know, she was trying to. I remember what it was. My dad was trying to buy a bottle of alcohol, and I guess he left his I forgot if he left his driver's license in his car or if he was just felt like being a troll and didn't feel like showing it. He was just like, "Look at me. Do I really look like I need to show you ID? Do I really need to? Do I look like?" Like, I need to prove that I'm 21 years or older. Like, seriously, do I really look under the age of 21? He's like, "I'm not showing you the ID." And she tried to press on it, right? So he put the bottle of alcohol aside and said, "I'm not buying it then. I'll go somewhere else and I'll buy it." Because it's fucking ridiculous to tell someone who's pushing 70 and to look at them. It's obvious. It's ridiculous to say, "Oh, I'm sorry. I can't let you buy this unless you show me your ID." It's like, well, fine. I just won't buy it here then.
Now you have to go put it back. Notice how you just made more work for yourself? How did that work out?
Yeah, exactly. Like, yeah, I won't buy it then. But people get so funny. My dad doesn't usually have this problem. He obviously looks old. He obviously is, and people never card him, but every once in a great rare while, he run into someone that just wants to try to assert their authority, and they're acting like, "Oh, I'm going to show everybody that I'm the boss of this situation." And my dad just likes to be like, "Hey, guess what? You're not the boss of the situation. You're just someone with an attitude problem."
That's great. It reminds me of, I had just gotten out of jail in Colorado, and they put me in this room with this lady who had a serious attitude problem. She's talking to me about stuff, and I guess I'm being a smart ass because that's what I do. Even right after getting out of jail, I'm still a smart ass.
Here's a question. Why were you in jail, if I may ask?
I was in jail.
I can't imagine you going to jail.
A court appearance that I had put off for like 6 months, and the judge was just so mad by the time. I had just trolled the judge so hard. The judge was just like, "You go to jail now."
And what was this court thing for? Some minor parking ticket or what?
It was a very minor violation of driving without a license, registration, or proof of insurance.
Okay. And if I may ask, why did you not have any of that?
I was Poe.
Okay, so at the time you just couldn't afford to get that stuff, but you chose to drive anyway.
I was earning $9 an hour, and I had a sports car. Eh.
He was Poe.
I was Poe. Yeah.
But some things were important in life.
Yeah, and alcohol was more important to me at that juncture than driver's license. So anyway, that's how I ended up in jail. It was less than 24 hours. They spat me out so fast that the jailer could not handle me because I followed all the rules, like, to the letter. And, man, yeah, there is nothing that infuriates them more than following all the rules.
Oh, yeah, totally. I love when I'm confronted by an arrogant cop, I do the kill him with kindness thing. I'm just, like, sickeningly sweet polite because there's no law against being too nice. So they really can't do anything, but they know I'm trolling them and just being a complete dick in a polite way, but I have plausible deniability because they know that I know that what I'm doing is aggravating them, but there's just no law against being, you know, too polite. And there's one time where this one cop, like, I forgot the exact thing, but, you know, he didn't like my air of confidence. So he decided he was going to try to take me down a few notches and thinking, okay, well, you know, this guy's just must be just putting on a pretense. So if I get up in his face, he's going to do something stupid and give me a reason to arrest him, you know? So he gets all up arrogant in my face and, oh, well, did you know this? And like some sort of like crazy scene out of like Miami Vice or something. I felt like I was in a fucking movie or something. It was really like bizarre. And the only thing I was afraid of was not being able to hold back my laughter, because inside I just wanted to bust out laughing so hard because of the way this guy was acting. But I was just keeping a straight face and just everything he said. Oh, yes, sir. No, sir. Okay. Yes, sir. No, sir. Okay, sir. I understand, sir. Yes, sir. No, sir. And he stormed off pissed. Like he saw that he was not going to get a reaction out of me to give him an excuse to lock me up. So he just like stormed off because I was, again, just following everything to the letter and not giving him any trouble, despite the fact that he was getting up in my face. So
mm-hmm.
That was pretty hilarious.
Interesting. Yeah, so to continue the story, when I was in the room with this lady, she's like, she looks at me and she says, you realize that I have the power to put you back in jail, right? And I said, well, that would actually be pretty nice. I haven't had a vacation in a while. And I mean, like, you guys feed me in there. The water is hot. There's no bills. There's no rent. And all my money is just earning interest in a bank account while the state is paying to feed me. So go ahead, put me back in jail. And she was so mad. She was so enraged.
Because you were unfuckwithable.
I was just unfuckwithable. Okay, well, put me back in there. Like, I learned so much in jail. Like, I met the neatest people. I'll be next.
Your finger peeking out anytime.
That was the other thing I told her. I said, I met the most interesting people. You can bet I'll be networking that with them now that I'm out of jail. Yeah. But if you'd like to spend your tax dollars to put me back in there, that's totally okay. It's just, how high do you want your tax bill to be?
That's funny.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But just just not being able to be messed with when somebody who is like in a position of minor authority tries to lord it over you. It's hilarious. Mm-hmm. Like, seriously, I was out of jail within 24 hours. How much power do you really think you have to put me back in there? Not a lot.
Yeah, and you made it clear that if you went back in there between the two of you, the only one that's going to feel inconvenienced isn't you.
Right, she's gonna have to fill out the paperwork.
And deal with your app.
And deal with me.
Uh-huh. Yeah, exactly.
Want a repeat of this? I'm the person who made you feel bad today. Sorry.
And you made her feel bad by not feeling bad yourself, because misery loves company, and you didn't give misery any company.
Exactly. It was funny when you said that. And now I feel like, actually just yesterday I had an interaction with a police officer. I went to the bathroom behind where I work, which is, I go in there, there's a police officer using the bathroom. And this restroom has a key on it. So it's a lockable door. It's not like it's open to the public.
Yeah.
And the homeless people are known to go in there and do drugs.
IV drugs.
IV drugs. And so that's why we keep it locked. And so I walk in there, and I'm all dressed up nice, you know, from selling art. And I see the officer come out. I'm like, oh, yeah, how's it going, officer? He said, it's going good. I said, so how am I supposed to do IV drugs if you're actually in here? Like, I'm supposed to be, like, kind of discreet. You're actually in my drug den, and yeah, I'm gonna have to ask you to leave.
I mean, you let him know you were kidding, right?
No, I think the fact that I was wearing a polo made it clear that I was kidding. Yeah, and he's like, here, man, I didn't see a thing. He was cool.
He got the joke.
Obviously. Seriously, yeah. I walked out of the art gallery.
Yeah, but that one lady, from what you were saying in the jail, reminds me of something that happened to me when I was dealing with the whole, you know, fence witch thing back in the day, when I had this, you know, psychotic neighbor next door that we nicknamed Fence Witch. I'm not going to go into the whole story, but let's just say that the property owners were renting, and they ended up renting to very much the wrong person. Really nasty individual. So, you know, she would call the cops on us for like every little thing. I mean, no joke, we'd water the lawn and she'd call the cops, like any little thing. So the cops really didn't know, they couldn't feel out which one of us was and wasn't full of shit, and they were getting sick of getting called back. In fact, we would joke around and say, oh, look, the babysitters are here when the cops came up. And they'd be like, what do you mean? It's like, well, she's using you as her personal babysitters, so, you know. Or we'd say, oh, have you come to protect us from the terrorists living next door? You know, things like that. And there was one time this one cop decided to get really cocky because there's this one section of the public easement that's kind of shared between private and public. You know how that goes. You got the front lawn, then the sidewalk, then the grass easement, and whatever. And, you know, we built, like a flower box thing there. And, you know, we had bushes and trees and flowers and, you know, all nice and decorated. And this one cop decided he wanted to be all authoritative and everything. And he's like, he's looking at me and he's like, okay, now I could, if I wanted to, I could just go and grab onto those plants in there and just pull everything out, because that's public property and I'm a cop and I could do that if I want to, but why would I do that? Why would I do that? And I said, I don't know. That would be a really stupid thing to do, and only a moron would do that, and you look like a really smart man. I don't know why a man as smart as you would go and do something that completely stupid. So I don't know. Why would you do that? That doesn't make any sense to me at all. He's like, okay, let me rephrase this. If I were to go in there and grab one of those bushes and yank it out, you probably wouldn't like that very much, would you? That's not something that you would like. That's not something you would want me to do. And I said, no, that would kind of suck, and I wouldn't want you to do that. But I must admit, there is one aspect of it that I think would be absolutely hilarious, because when you would grab your bare hands tightly around the wild rose that I have growing in there, and all those thorns go right into your hands, and they'd be able to hear you screaming down the block, I have to admit that would actually be extremely funny. And that's when he decided to, you know, just kind of leave.
Right. We have gardening gloves for a reason. Nope, they've dropped. Woohoo, I'm all alone.
Sorry, I got punted, but I'm back now. Yeah, I got punted by Google for a second. It happens to Rich way more than it happens to me, but I guess it was just my turn or whatever, but I'm back now.
Okay.
But yeah, you were saying something, Paul? He's Paul still there?
Right now, hang on.
Oh, okay. Not a problem. But yeah, getting back to this being, you know, a year of integration, I mean, just the idea of integration where we take this contrast, and instead of moving into an idea of, oh, you know, we have to avoid that negative thing or fight that negative thing, that, oh, I'm a victim and we need to have psychopathic babysitters lorded over us and whatever else, moving into seeing things more as opportunity instead of burden, and thinking, all right, you know, how can we use this as nitrous in the gas tank? How can we take this shit and use it as fertilizer to, you know, grow ourselves that garden of positivity that we're wanting, and, you know, moving into greater realization of personal responsibility and out of this poor little me attitude. And I think the more that the powers who assume they be fight each other to struggle to consolidate power, and tyranny gets more transparent, the social justice warriors do their thing and whatever, it's kind of just like the dark in service to the light, for lack of a better way of saying it, because it's forcing more and more people to to wake up and start thinking along lines that, you know, they never thought of before. Like, for example, take Trump, for example. Whether you love or hate Trump, he's definitely got people thinking about things they never thought of before. And really, you know, just taking things into consideration that they had never taken into consideration before. So even just as far as topics and speaking points, you know, and all of that, he's kind of been stirring the pot, as Tobias Lars likes to call it. And, you know, all this stuff comes up so that we have to face it and take personal responsibility and deal with it instead of keeping it pushed down and ignoring it and letting things fester and doing the same old, same old. So, you know, 2017 seems like it's going to be a really big year for that sort of thing, both on the individual personal level for each of us in our own lives, as well as collectively. So I think it's just going to be an extremely interesting year.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a very interesting year too. I mean, all of these personalities, all of these extreme personalities are born of other extreme personalities. And I feel like the pendulum swings one way and then it swings the other way, but eventually it comes to rest in the middle. And 2017 is one of those coming to rest in the middle kind of years when things are stable. I think 2017 is going to be a year when, at least for me personally, like my life is going to be very stable comparative to 2015 and 2016.
Yeah. I mean, I didn't, you know, when I, you know, got the feeling that this is going to be the year of integration, like, you know, when I was first started getting that feeling, the numerology didn't even dawn on me. Like when you add up the numbers of the year, it's a 9, and nine is about bringing things to completion, or like you said, stabilization. And ironically enough, Trump is also a 9. I do believe he's like the 45th president or something. So 4 + 5 = 9, completion. Not to say that he's going to be a savior or anything, but just symbolically representing maybe that completion point where we start to look at the idea of, okay, maybe we should bring this old paradigm to an end. And, you know, the idea that, like, what Buckminster Fuller once said, that you don't create the new by fighting the old. The way you do it is by making the old obsolete. Like, you know, the 2016 Lamborghini Diablo did not have a fierce battle with Henry Ford's Model T, and that, you know, just one out over the other. It's just a process that as you keep improving things, over time, the things that are better and more efficient become more widely accepted. And what is less efficient becomes obsolete eventually. And yeah, there's resistance at first. Like when electricity was first created, there was huge resistance against it. Some people thought it was just not needed. Like, oh, what do you need electricity for? Look at everything I already have. It already serves me just fine. Electricity is an unnecessary luxury. Who would even need it? Then there's the idea of, oh, electricity is from Satan. It's demonic. It's from the devil. It's this unseen energy that makes things happen. So that can only come from Satan. And there's all these crazy ideas about electricity before it got accepted. So there was some opposition, just like there was opposition to cars in the beginning. Like, you know, you've got a horse and a buggy and you've got 2 feet, you've got bicycles. And why do you need anything more than that? More than that is too excessive. So it's like all good new things always have this resistance from some people, because they want to remain stuck in their sameness. But as these things persist and become more widely accepted, then the old thing becomes obsolete and no longer used. So when it comes to the various, you know, mechanisms of tyranny, both the internal mind prison and, you know, as above, so below, out in the greater world stage as well, I think the more people, excuse me, move into a mindset of curiosity and creativity and innovation and making things better, rather than this control freaky trying to hold on to things and fight other things, and that domineering, you know, sort of I'm justified my way, wah 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 sort of drive, I think that we're going to start seeing things get better and better. Also, we also have to understand that, you know, even though a lot of the, you know, rich psychopaths who give no fuck about anybody, even though on one aspect they want to fit in with, you know, their buddies at their level and go along with Agenda 21 and all these other game plans, first and foremost, they are out for themselves. And that has actually led to some ironically unexpected positive things, because they want to make money in their industries, and a lot of them are starting to learn that helping people makes more money than fucking them. And they're starting to see this, and they're thinking, oh, if everybody else is in this mindset of fucking people, but I know that helping the people is better and makes more money faster, then I can totally just kick all my competition's ass, because right now I'm the only one seeing the light about that. So I'm going to be able to have that competitive edge and make more money faster. And also, like, you know, there's a lot of like dangerous elements, you know, about the curly light bulbs in so many ways that they're unsafe, but, you know, that's done on purpose as per Agenda 21. So you would think that the powers that be wouldn't allow something as safe and awesomely efficient as the new LED light bulbs, but that is being allowed out because, you know, somebody up there is saying, hey, I like personal profits better than I like going according to the agenda of my peers. So I'm going to go and I'm going to make more money than them and have that competitive edge. So a negative greed aspect is actually starting to have a positive effect. The more a lot of these, you know, greedy rich people that used to make their money by fucking people over are starting to see, you know, helping people out actually makes more money. Doing things fairly, making things of good quality, embracing more innovation, you know, that actually makes more money. And if I do this, I'll be able to minimize my expenses, maximize my profits, and, you know, totally have my own little empire. So nothing's ever just black or white. There's always shades of gray. This is one of those weird shades where something inherently negative can morph into something that's very positive.
Yeah, as happens in many instances, many cases. It's Adam Smith talked about the invisible hand that moves the market. And I feel like there's an invisible hand in ethics as well, because whenever you get money involved, there is definitely that that desire to outperform your peers, as you were saying. And this is really what makes the market work the way that it does. So it's fascinating to watch it.
Yeah, because we're starting to move out of that idea of having a disposable society making money on things breaking and fucking people over into new paradigms. Because what a lot of people don't realize as well, like, you know, a lot of these older industries feel threatened by the new ones. And they're thinking, oh, well, if my current industry becomes obsolete, then there's going to be money lost, jobs lost, it's going to damage the economy, it's going to create chaos. So we need to fight against the new to maintain our current stability. And what they don't realize is that for every new industry that opens up, millions of jobs open up with it, and, you know, millions of new opportunities for, you know, rich people to get even richer off of these new industries. And the only reason people, you know, feel threatened by, you know, oh my God, you know, these illegal immigrants are taking our jobs, or, oh, machine automation is putting people out of work and this and that and the other. The only reason that sort of thing is actually even able to happen is because of the technological ceiling that's been put in place by captains of industries that actually fear expansion, that fear innovation, that think that that's their enemy, that they need to maintain these obsolete ways of doing things, otherwise the new is going to destroy the old, and then where will they be? And another part of it is that if a lot of these people are at the top of their game and they're in first place, they don't want to end up in 10th place, 20th place, 30th place. For them, it's not as much about the money as it is the power and influence. So if they're no longer top dog, then they're worried about their power and their influence and their control that they have over the ebb and flow of things. And they're thinking, oh, well, if other people rise higher than me, then I'm not going to be able to have as much control as I had. And if I can't have that, then my preferred lifestyle won't be able to be sustained the way I like it. And then, oh, whatever shall I do? They don't really realize that it doesn't matter if you're the top dog or not, as long as you're doing what you need to do for your own continuity. And that if you want to continue to expand and increase that continuity, you have to be more open-minded to new industries and new opportunities and new technologies, instead of working off of the old dysfunctional, disposable society method. Because even if you were to make a product that's not only cheap to make, but will last decades, centuries, maybe even, if you make it well enough, you're not going to lose money on it, because there's always going to be so many new products for so many things as innovation unfolds and new ideas unfold, that there's never going to be a shortage of anything to sell and never a shortage of anybody to buy if they keep that expansion going. But in a disposable society where we're not recycling much, we're creating garbage and we're operating under a system of everything breaking, there's not really, you know, much room for that expansion. So it's kind of put it in this finite, inflexible area that cannot be sustained, but that if we keep trying to stay here, civilization can and will collapse if we don't allow for that expansion. So I think a lot more people are realizing this now and are starting to, you know, be more willing to allow for that expansion. And I think that's also a part of that integration process as well. We're finally starting to realize it's slow. It's not as fast as we want it to be, but it's faster than most people think it would be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the role of technology has really assisted with that integration. Specifically, the role of the internet insofar as it's allowed people from disparate backgrounds to communicate with each other. There's a chapter in The Grapes of Wrath where John Steinbeck is talking about how all of the various characters are all sitting in their own settings, all alone, thinking that this is happening to them. And The Grapes of Wrath is about the Dust Bowl and about the Depression and about things which are bad, which are happening to people. And it's very interesting because, you know, pre the internet, that's precisely what people would do. They would operate with the limited information available to them. And everybody pretty much thought they were having their own experience and that they were having their experience alone, when in fact it was a collective experience. And the internet is magnifying the fact that it's a collective experience.
Mm-hmm.
Which is really assisting with integration, because it's a hell of a lot easier to integrate when you realize that there are millions of people just like you going through the same stuff, and you can talk to them and connect to them and reach out to them and learn from them and have them learn from you.
Yeah, and everything is, of course, a double-edged sword. I mean, you know, the internet has brought just as much petty bickering as it has people coming together in understanding. And you know, when we see both, we start to realize that which one we do is our choice. It's not anything being forced on us. And that if we choose to go more in the direction of being understanding and empathetic while still standing in our sovereignty, I don't mean letting everybody, like, you know, fuck you over and whatever and be a doormat and whatever else, but, you know, being willing to, at the very least, understanding where someone is coming from who you strongly disagree with, instead of attacking them and saying, no, you're wrong and I'm right, fuck you, and
you
all
like
this.
Experience? Yeah.
But, you know, it's like within that, like, then what we find out is that when we stand in that sovereignty, but at the same time having no desire to fight with everybody, then most of the people who want to fight with us get very bored with us very quickly. We become very insufferable to them. I refer to this as benevolent trolling, of course, or, you know, killing them with kindness is another way of putting it. But kindness, not even necessarily in that Disney sort of, oh, I love you sort of way. I mean, sometimes, you know, kindness is dished out with a hammer. It's not all flowers. But when I refer to kindness, I just mean, you know, being willing to have that understanding and that respect for somebody else's position, even if you don't agree with them, and even if you think that person is scummy, to have that understanding and respect so that you don't feel the need to try to dominate them and force them to your will, when you can respect that it's okay if they don't like you or don't resonate with you or they think you're a scumbag or whatever it is that they might think, no matter how negative, that you could just sit there like, all right, well, I obviously don't agree with you, but, you know, that's your right to think that. And I happen to be an advocate of liberty and freedom, and freedom is the right to someone to say what you don't like, don't want, don't think. Otherwise, what then is freedom? So once you get into that mode, the people who are addicted to the bickering and the back and forth, they don't even want to deal with you. And you start to get a reputation among those people too, which helps you as well. Because your reputation among those people becomes, oh, well, Dave Kelso is insufferable, you know. So don't even bother dealing with him. Just shun him completely because he's insufferable, because he thinks this, this, and this, and you know, he's not willing to fight. He's not willing to go at it with us. He's not willing to try to let us dominate him or to try to dominate us. He's not willing to have that war. So he's the lowest of the low. Don't even waste your time. And then getting that reputation among that type of groups of people mean if those groups stay away from you, that means you're at peace, there's no drama. And the only people who can approach you are of the more open-minded variety. That doesn't necessarily mean everyone within that variety is going to get along with you, but it, at the very least, it means that you're going to have few, if any, of those people that are like actively wanting to fuck with other people. They might be going through their own paradigm, so you might have your collisions with them and whatever, but they're not like actively out to, like, you know, battle you and have this big heated whatever. You know what I mean?
I do know what you mean. Yeah, the people. You know, Katerina and I refer to it as like people vibrate right out of your reality.
Mm-hmm.
Things will as well. I recall that I walked into a store the other day, and there was this homeless person like sitting right outside the store, just yelling and screaming and swearing at everybody who was passing by. I did not notice this person, and not because I didn't have compassion for them, but just because people who yell and scream and swear at me are so far outside of my reality that I just don't notice that they exist. The only reason I noticed this person existed is because everybody around me was acting all butthurt. And finally I looked around and I'm like, oh, and this person's screaming incendies at me. I guess if I was in a place where I would be butthurt by somebody screaming obscenities for me, then this person would have appeared in my reality. But they just didn't.
I'd probably have noticed, but just found it funny, just laughed, just been like, man, you know, just some people aren't happy unless they just aren't happy.
Right. Like, okay, well, best of luck with the obscenity screaming. I mean, hopefully that gets you a job or whatever.
Yeah. I probably would have, like, whipped out my camera, instant PSEC episode. Like, this is a tutorial as to how to not apply for employment at a grocery store.
That's a fact. I thought it was amusing because, you know, I find that, you know, there are definitely people who are crazy makers in my life, mm-hmm. and in Katerina's life, but we find that they're very much satellites. They're kind of like orbiting at a distance. Just mm-hmm. every now and then they kind of make their presence known, but we never engage. Mm-hmm. They just go along their merry way. They're just looking for somebody to engage with. You just don't.
Yeah, and you don't have the receiver dish at the bottom, so you're not locked on.
Right. Not locked onto that.
So they get to deal with those who are locked on.
Right, and more power to them, because honestly, in a perverse way, they really enjoy doing that to each other.
Yeah.
So, you know what? Like, let them have their joy. Who am I to rob them of their joy of being miserable?
Yeah, that's what they want.
That's what they want. They can have it.
Yeah, because really, really, if you look at it, it's like, what right do I have to try to tell them that, they can't have that, you know? Then that would be doing the thing that I'm saying shouldn't be done, and that would just make me an instant hypocrite.
Mm-hmm. Right, exactly. So therefore, if they want to have that, and if that's the thing that they desire, well, then go have it, and have it with my blessing. But have it with somebody else who wants to have it with you.
Yeah, I mean, you know, the way I used to be a long time ago, it's like, I think we all had our moments where we used to dive into that kind of stuff. I mean, just the way society is. But these days, it's just, it's really uninteresting. Like, unless something is, like, really over the top, like some of these social justice warriors that I can't help but, like, bust out laughing at because it's hilarious. It's like South Park becomes real or something. It's just over the top. Like, save for something that extreme, you know, I just look at this other shit. It's like, it's really pointless. It's like, I really have no desire to have any involvement. It's like, I see it, you know, scroll through as just a brief mention or whatever, something going on. I'm just like, yeah, well, that's interesting. And just whatever. And I'm just moving on by it because I don't really care to get wrapped up in it. Sometimes there are things that jump out that are just extremely hilarious. And like, I'll point those out because it's funny, you know. I mean, paradigm shift in educational comedy, right? I mean, why not laugh at stuff? But I really have no interest in directly interacting, you know, within all these dramas and stuff. And it's like, and you know, petitions too. Like, I think that the purpose of a petition is for everybody to let each other know that they are on the same page when it comes to a certain point of view. But other than that, they serve no purpose because what? You're going to petition the shark to not eat you? Really? Like that's going to work? Well, if we get enough signatures from the tuna, the shark will be forced to change its mind. No. The shark's still going to do what the shark's going to do because it's a shark. And that's what the shark does. And no amount of signatures on a petition is going to change that. That's also what the people in the Occupy movements didn't realize as well. It's like, if you're out there trying to bring awareness to the rest of the people around you that problems exist, fine. But if you're trying to, you know, to confront the fat cats on Wall Street and the dirty politicians and say, we demand that you change because we're out here in droves demanding it, all that tells the politicians and the Wall Street fat cats, they're laughing like, okay, we have them right where we want them because they're showing us that they're not willing to make a move without us doing anything. They still expect us to do it for them. They refuse to do anything for themselves. They're just like a bunch of screaming five-year-olds going, mommy, daddy, we want you to do this and we're going to cry and hold our breath until you do it. And so they're just showing them that, you know, just these psychopathic fat cats, they're looking at them like, okay, well, they're right where we want them. They're not going to take their sovereignty. They're like little children making demands of dysfunctional parents. So we're just still going to do whatever we want, regardless of what they demand, because they're showing us they're not willing to actually do anything.
I feel like a petition is like a social permission slip to not do anything else except come out against a problem, you know, intellectually. It's a way of saying, oh, I stand against this thing so fervently that I'll sign the paper, but not actually do anything else.
Yeah.
And because there's 10,000 of us, then surely this must have some effect.
Yeah, but it has none.
It has none at all.
The only effect it has is letting more people know just how many people feel, you know, about a particular topic. But other than that, it doesn't actually do anything.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You can bet that Standing Rock is still happening and that all the people who signed petitions are not aware of it.
Yeah, I mean, as a matter of fact, the only thing that really seems to work in that regard, and kind of thinking back to the Matrix movies where it was said that the machines have to obey the rules of their own matrix, that they too are locked, you know, within that structure. We vote with our dollars, not at the polls. So if you don't like something a corporation is doing, withdraw your funding from that corporation, because that corporation doesn't survive on hugs and kisses and good intentions and whatever. That corporation survives on money that it needs for funding to continue its operations. As a matter of fact, there's been like so much boycotting of GMOs that Monsanto ended up redlining so bad that Bayer had to actually buy Monsanto. In order to keep Monsanto afloat, because people were voting with their dollars. People were saying, hey, we're not going to buy these products. And just like how Tropicana orange juice just went, you know, recently went non-GMO, because not only were a lot of people in the United States not buying Tropicana because they were GMO and too many people didn't want the GMO, but most other countries in the world will not buy GMO. There's a global boycott on GMO in most countries. So Tropicana is like, shit, if we're not able to sell to what we need for profit margins locally, and we're not hardly able to sell internationally, we're going to go broke if we don't do something about this. Mm-hmm. So the only thing they could do is stop doing the GMO shit so that people would start buying from them.
It's the only language that business understands is money, and money is a social construct anyways, so it really has no importance except that which we ascribe to it.
Yeah, and like all the people who are trying to boycott the DAPL pipeline and all that, you know, if they really wanted to do something helpful towards that, all they'd have to do is buy a gallon or two less of gas per week than they normally would. When you multiply that by 100 million plus drivers, you know, that sends a financial message, because the oil companies see that they just took a sharp drop in their profits.
Yep.
And when you then equate that as a form of protest about the pipeline, then the oil corporations might be like, shit, well, maybe we don't want to go fucking with these people, because maybe they'll start boycotting even more.
Yep.
So yeah, there's so much gas money that gets spent just on, you know, people feeling too lazy to walk to the store that's two blocks away to get their couple items, or, you know, going out instead of ordering in, or whatever the case may be. There's so many things that they spend gas money on that don't absolutely need to be spent on. And those are the things that they can cut back on, you know, for their boycott. They don't have to cut back on going to work, you know, right. But they can cut back on the extra shit that they normally spend on and go, well, you know, maybe I'll do something different. Maybe I'll walk my ass two blocks over to that store, or I'll order pizza in, because that pizza delivery guy is going to be out there anyway servicing people. So instead of him and me being out there, it'll be just right. him.
It's just him. Mm-hmm. Yep, pretty much. And with alternative technologies and transportation becoming so much more prevalent, you know that electric motorcycles now have a similar range to gasoline-powered motorcycles, but are otherwise superior to every way.
Oh like, yeah, well, just like the one, just like the one PSEC episode with you and Katerina in the Tesla, it had better acceleration than a gas vehicle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, by orders of magnitude. I mean, I've never been in a gas vehicle that accelerated like that one does, and they've just made it faster over the years, and they've just made it go further.
Yeah.
They've just made them more reliable. And to the point where, like, I am now very seriously considering that I don't even want to own a gasoline motorcycle. I want to own an electric one. I don't even want to own a gasoline car. I'll own an electric car. I live on Maui. I don't need range. Where are you going to go? It's Maui.
Yeah, and then, like, here in Chicago, on the sides of all the buses, like, they made it a point to advertise that the buses are hybrid gas electric now.
Okay.
So, you know, they've got the hybridization going, so they're not using as much gas.
Yep. Yeah. And you know, with automatic driving cars, which are coming, you know, give it 3 years, we're gonna see auto drivers on the road. They're gonna use less gas too, because
you're not going to have people with a lead foot. You're going to have people who push the button, and the car will most efficiently drive itself to where it needs to go.
Yeah, you're probably going to start to have special lanes going for that, that, you know, have under and overpasses that go above and below the normal traffic, so they don't even need stoplights or anything because the cars are auto-driven, so you're right. not going to have car accidents.
Yeah, I know. It's going to be amazing. And just in the next 5 years or so, in transportation specifically, right? And as you were saying before, old industries cling to their old paradigms. The oil industry is obviously in bed with the automaking industry, which is, you know, they're all repurposing themselves as energy companies. But they're still fighting for their old model, for their old paradigm.
Yeah.
Really, that's what allows Elon Musk to do what he does. That's the only reason we have a Tesla, is because GM literally... Like they had electric cars in the 90s. They crushed them.
Yeah. And then look at like the one maglev train that you were on in China that I'm damn sure is electric, that is not gas, and that thing goes like 300 miles per hour.
Yeah, that was impressive. Yeah, that thing does. It goes 300. Yeah, I've gone 300 miles an hour on a train. Neato. I'd forgotten about that.
Oh, you have, huh? I mean, hell, I can...
My life is, like, full of interesting shit.
I can actually, if you just give me a moment, I can actually,
play the PSEC.
I can pull that footage up. I can actually go straight to it. I mean, I'm only going to play the section with the train, but, the full episode for, you know, the people watching this one, is on scrolling down to it.
All Shanghai Adventure, I believe.
Yeah. Yes, I know. I'm looking for the full... yeah. What the hell was that? 2050? Trying to find whether or not that was 2015 or 2016. Maybe that was... Was it 2016?
Yeah, that was 2016.
Yeah, there it is. I mean, we've been doing, I've had PSEC since 2011, so this is the seventh year. So, like, after a while, you start to, like, think, huh, what year was that one anyway? PSEC 2016 calls Shanghai Adventure. One sec, I'm just going to load it up and then jump to the...
Yeah, it will be near the end.
The train part.
Yeah, I had the Shanghai train near the end.
I know where it is.
Okay. Well, yeah, you cut the whole video together, I think.
Yep. Hold on. Okay, yeah. I'm going to disengage my headphones, and I'm going to engage... Screen share. You can see this, right?
I can.
And on the way out, I figured I would do at least one touristy thing. So instead of having my driver drop me off at the airport, have him drop me off at the maglev station. So here's that fun adventure.
Did an extreme slow motion replay.
Right along, about 50 kilometers an hour.
Chicago needs trains like this.
On this side, there will be another train. 100 kilometers an hour.
Been a 30 to 40 minute drive, my driver tells me.
Thank you.